Thank you very much for participating and joining us tonight for this screening. I'm Phil Carter. I lead a research program at CNAS focused on veterans and military personnel issues. We're going to bring down a couple of folks to join our panel discussion in a minute. Here are two more of them coming down the aisle now. Go through some brief introductions. We'll have a brief conversation and then open up to discussion with all of you all as you're watching the final credits roll behind us. I'm joined to my right and your left by General Craig McKinley. I'm told that anytime you, General retired Craig McKinley, anytime you introduce an Air Force officer who's flown, you should talk about what he has flown. So you've flown the F-15, the F-16, a lot of other aircraft. Craig served as the first chief of the National Guard Bureau to serve on the Joint Chiefs of Staff from 2008 until 2012. And in that capacity was chief of the National Guard Bureau during the engagements that you saw on the film. Wendy Anderson, to his right, is a long-serving national security professional who, in addition to being executive producer of this film and a partner in Strong Eagle Media, also served in the Pentagon as chief of staff for Ash Carter, now Secretary of Defense, during the time that these events were taking place. To her right and your left is Staff Sergeant Justin Smith, who is an infantry sergeant in the Kansas Army National Guard, but at the time of this film was a squad leader in the 45th Infantry Brigade Combat Team. And at the end of the film, we see that sergeant telling the soldier to call on the 9-line and stay focused. That's Staff Sergeant Smith. To his right, on the far left, is Dr. Jason Dempsey, who is a retired Army infantry officer with more than 20 years of service in Ranger, light, and mechanized units, including two tours in Afghanistan and one in Iraq. Jason's also one of the nation's leading civ-mil relations scholars and the author of a book titled Our Army. We hope to be joined in a little bit by Representative Tulsi Gabbard. She is at the moment doing her job, which is great as a member of Congress. She's in a vote on the Hill, and we hope to have her here in just a few more minutes. You know, while we're all sort of processing the film, why don't I start with just a general question to you, which I think is a question a lot of us are wrestling with having watched it now. What'd you think?
This is the first time I've seen it on the big screen. I've watched it on laptops before, so it gives you a little more emotion when you see it on this big screen. And it's really a wonderful production. And Wendy and Strong Eagle, you guys did a great job capturing this. I was with about 4,000 of my closest friends a couple weeks ago up in Baltimore, and it was all the leadership of the National Guard. And I think what you want to emphasize is this is about the 45th, no doubt, but it's about every soldier who fought and is fighting. It's about every Marine. This is land component warfare. When you talk about high ground, this shows it very dramatically what that terrain is like. And for all of us who've been there, it's impressive. I've never seen anything like it, and I grew up in the Rockies. But it's every soldier, it's every Marine, it's every person who's put on a uniform or a civilian who's deployed with our soldiers and Marines. So I'm impressed every time I see it. Wendy showed me the early shots of this, and it gets better every time I see it. I see something different every time I see it, but it's a powerful movie.
Greatly appreciate General McKinley saying that, and I should say, although he gave some version of the story, the truth is that in addition to Michelle Flournoy and Sean Bremley and some other great folks like Phil from CNAS, General McKinley was one of the first people that I reached out to and said, David Salzberg, who is the co-director of the film, who is here somewhere, David, there you go. We want to show you an early version of it. We want to get this right. We have a set of storytelling principles that we've tried to abide by, which is that 2.8 million men and women have deployed since 9/11. We don't want to use actors. We really want to try to curate and be attentive to our service members who have experienced Iraq and Afghanistan firsthand. We don't want to be political. I mean, who wants to do that? You know, we want to have the service member at the center of a story. We want to involve the Gold Star families. I want to recognize Jane Horton, who's here. And I just really, please stand, Jane. You've been a tremendous advocate for Gold Star families. Bonnie Carroll is here with an amazing person who's come with her tonight, and I want to recognize the two of you and the relative, the sibling, the brother that you lost. The Gold Star families have been central to the integrity, I think, of the films, and had it not been for the engagement of the Gold Stars, of Lieutenant Lehan and Sergeant Prince, you would have seen a really different film tonight. Because had those families ever said to us, we don't want you to focus on our loved one for whatever reason, then, as David Salzberg and I have talked about so frequently, we would have honored that and we would have done a different film. If we aren't worth those families and those sacrifices, as Jane can attest to, then we're not worth what we're doing and we shouldn't be doing it. The fourth thing that I wanted to say, Phil, is folks like Staff Sergeant Smith, who, as General John Allen has said, that is the most important leadership NCO moment he has ever seen in his 42-year career as a Marine Corps officer and as our former COM ISAF. I agree with that. General McKinley agrees with that. These guys have been our full partners in the telling of the story, truly, and Justin will tell you all about that in a second. But when I was able to show General McKinley the film and General Hargett of Naugus way, way, way back, literally the first thing he said to me is, you said, you know, Wendy, I got to tell you, you guys, the whole Strong Eagle Media team, has told not just that story of the Oklahoma 45th, but you've actually told the story of every single National Guard unit in the country that's deployed. And that is what is really significant about the film.
Justin, what's your reaction sitting here as the one in the audience who has lived what those events are on the film?
I think to start out, it's important that I'm upfront and honest with you that at the very beginning of all of this, when this was just an idea, I wasn't enthusiastic about the film at all. I didn't like the idea. It didn't sound like a good idea, and I wasn't the only one. Most of us, in fact, absolutely were completely stiff arm resistant to anything like this. This was a bad idea. You know, this is footage that we had. I mean, it's our footage that we turned in that they knit together so well. But at that moment, in the beginning, it was just between us. We'd share it back and forth. We would relive these little moments with each other and just each other. This is very private. It's very personal stuff. I see a couple of uniforms and pins and can just assume that there's much more military service in the audience than is apparent on the surface. But even for those of you who have never served, let me put a question to you. Would you let me follow you around with a camera on your very worst day and then show the world that bad day with your husband or your wife? That awful day at work. What do you think about sharing that with everybody? And we hated the idea. It was a bad idea. So that's my disclaimer up front. Aaron Harrell, Staff Sergeant now, he was the guy that had the idea. He was the guy that carried the ball. When everybody else said, no go, he saw something deeper there. He saw potential for something a lot more than any of the rest of us did. And he carried that all by himself for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And I really have to honor him for that and thank him for that. He met not just resistance, but again, he met hostility with it. And then for us, being how we are, some of you can relate to this, what finally got us on board was my platoon leader and my platoon sergeant, Lieutenant Brown and Sergeant First Class Byrne. They came to us and they said, all right, boys. They came to the squad leaders, still the chain of command. We hadn't been an actual unit. They broke us up as soon as we got home. That's just how you do it. It's a necessary thing. So we hadn't been an integrated unit for a while, but still, they came to the squad leaders first. So they're like, all right, boys, it's time to get behind this. and still didn't agree with it, but hey, they said go. So we got with the Joes and we said, all right, it's time to go. And for most all of us, then at that point, what it became was a leap of faith. And the leap of faith was based on a conversation that some of us had had with David Salzberg. He used this term in the conversation that really caught my ear. He was talking about this other film they did, The Hornet's Nest. I hadn't seen it at the time. He mentioned digital medicine is the phrase, the little catchphrase. Never heard those two words put together in that order before. I'm really curious about it, but it was intriguing at best. For the promise that it could do something good, and this thing, digital medicine, that I had no idea what that could possibly be, I went ahead and threw in with it. Again, most completely because my platoon leader said, hey, it's time to be a team and unite and go forward on this together. So, okay, if it's going to be a bad idea, we're all going to have it together. Let's go. And we did. And I watched to see what this digital medicinal quality was and where it was, and lo and behold, I've seen it, and that's why I am I'm bought into it now, if you will, and so many of the other guys now have the same, because we've seen some of the result, we've felt some of the result, and there's so many different areas that this film is impactful for civilians that have never had any type of military affiliation or service. What we see and what I hope is that they now realize and know more fully and firsthand what it is that they're saying and why that they're saying thank you for your service when they see a veteran and they make that kind compliment, that kind comment. For combat veterans, I think the medicinal quality is the sense of solidarity that it gives us. It's a validation for, I don't know if this makes any sense. For me, the very first time I saw it, And really a little bit each time that I see it, even now tonight, it's a validation for me. You know, I'm a Christian and I don't believe in ghosts, but I do believe that memories can have a ghost-like quality, memories of people and places and events that can have a ghost-like quality, especially in the deep, dark places in your mind. And the things that were eating me from the inside out were winning. And I saw footage that I'd already seen, keep in mind, again, we had this, we shared this back and forth already, but to have it put together in a storyline, to have our story told in such an amazing way was validating. Yes, this happened. Yes, this is the way it went down. And it's okay that it happened. And I hope that other combat vets get that. And I've talked to them that are not even from our generation, our theater of operation, our branch of service, for that matter. There's this connection. We both put on the uniform at one point in time and put ourselves in harm's way with our friends. And that's a bond that you can't forge anywhere else in any other way. For the other veterans that haven't had the opportunity to deploy yet, I hope they see that this is the point, this is the culminating event. This is why we train so repetitively, hours upon end, days upon end, for that right there. We're not the Boy Scouts. This is what we do, ladies and gentlemen. For the families, and my biggest hope is for the families, is that for that soldier they had to let go of for a little while, and for some of them for good, I hope that they see what we did and how we were together. And although nothing can replace a lost soldier, and nothing can really make better the guy that you got home, the girl that you got home, that's not the same one you sent away, I hope this explains, or at least shows. You know, they say a picture is worth 1,000 words. Well, this is a motion picture, so this has got to be worth, like, you know, 100 million. And I tried, my own words, I tried to use probably close to 100 million words, and I'm not a big talker. I'm not a big touchy-feely guy. I don't like to hug it out and talk about how I'm feeling about a particular thing, but I tried it. I tried it with my wife for years, and we went to counseling with like a professional. We went to counseling with the pastor. We did workbooks. I read other books. I talked to my buddy. All the things they tell you you're supposed to do. They have whole classes dedicated to this in the different services. Hey, welcome home. You need to go through this reintegration counseling. Got it. I did it. And we were still sinking so fast. And we didn't know where to plug the hole. And although I tried, what it really was finally when we got to sit down together and watch this film. And for all the things that I couldn't say for all those years, she took a couple of days to really process it. You know, it's, well, I mean, you just saw it. It takes a little bit to process that. What she finally came to was a point of looking me in the eye and saying a very impactful statement, a very small statement, very impactful statement. She said that, I think I get it just a little bit better, just a little bit even better. I get it. And you know what? I can love this guy too. And having been treated with that medicine myself, I am completely enthusiastic now about helping to put it out there for other people and other veterans. And this is just, for me now at this point, this is just a continuation of the mission of not leaving a soldier behind. Because a lot of us do, I think, get left behind unintentionally, albeit, but even after we come home. And so this is what I get. Even still, I don't know, this is 30, 40, 50 times that I've seen it by now, and it still has that impact, and I still have that enduring hope that all these different groups and people will get the intent from this movie and get their dose of medicine.
Thank you. Jason, what are your reactions?
The film is absolutely a public service in the best sense of the word. And to Wendy and David for putting it together, you know, we should all be grateful, particularly to the men and women of the 45th. And I say men and women not just for the soldiers who serve, but for those they left behind. For them to share this, as was so eloquently stated, is tremendously helpful. You know, there's a great phrase that I caught. I've only seen this film a few times. And I was surprised I missed at the end until this viewing the phrase shared pain. And it's used in the context of how the soldiers bond and how they appreciate and come together. But as we all know, at least most of us in this room discuss almost ad nauseum, that pain doesn't often or too little does it emanate past the soldiers who serve and the families who support them. And that pain is isolated. And that pain leaves us without a communal sense that there is a shared sacrifice. And so this, in terms of this being a public service, the fact that it closes the distance and increases our understanding of what these soldiers have been through is tremendously, tremendously helpful. And I think it should be the goal of this film, and I think it's well achieved, that there's nobody who sees it who should not leave being deeply uncomfortable.
Thank you. And now welcome Congressman Gabbard. Thanks for joining us. So we'll give you a minute to warm up. We're just sharing reactions to the film. But while we've got the group here, General McKinley, let's start again with you. So the role of the Guard has changed a lot in the last 15 years. This is not the Guard that I served in 15 years ago. This is not the Guard that my father served in 40 years ago. We've gone from a strategic reserve to an operational reserve. We've deployed roughly 900,000 reserve component soldiers and sailors, airmen and Marines. Out of 2.8 million. Talk to us about this shift. Why have we relied so heavily on the reserves? What has it meant for the men and women who serve in the reserves? And what's the future look like for our reserve components, our citizen soldiers?
Well, it's no doubt that September 11th, 2001 changed everything, and I think at least 80% of our soldiers and airmen in the National Guard who we represent have joined since that day out of very patriotic and professional reasons. But it's no different than what we talked about on the film from 1636. This is how our country was formed. But what I experienced in the Pentagon as the first chief to have the opportunity and the honor to wear that rank was that Admiral Mike Mullen and General Marty Dempsey, who were our chairman, and Ray Odierno and George Casey, who were the chiefs of staff of the Army, and Norty Schwartz, who was chief of staff of the Air Force, and Mike Mosley before him. So we fall in on those formations. They knew that over time that we had had the training and the equipment and that we were ready to go. Army Guard a little different than the Air Guard, but nonetheless, we'd been training up to that point, and it was a matter of just running to the sound of the guns and sitting in the relative peace of the Pentagon. Those order books just kept coming out, and Secretary Gates and Secretary Panetta would come into the tank with us, and it was a very sobering time to say, this formation's next out the door. Are they ready to go? Can you commit to us that they're going to be okay? And you saw the names of the soldiers who didn't come home. That's a bunch. But proportionately, the National Guard has served from the beginning. So strategic to operational, 15 years of this, there doesn't appear to be any let up in sight. Congresswoman Gabbard spoke at our conference a couple weeks ago. This is steady state for your Guard and your Reserve now. And they're at the peak of their performance. They're at peak of readiness. We have some of the most professional soldiers and airmen in the National Guard that I've ever seen. And I served through the entire Cold War. But it's not going to change. Our land component forces are small. General Milley talks about it all the time. We're asking these soldiers, especially in the Army and the Army National Guard and the Army Reserve, to do an awful lot. It did break the mold of people having civilian jobs like our fathers did, you, me, and then going a couple days a month and a couple weekends, a couple weeks in the summer. That's gone, and I don't see it changing, and I don't think anybody wants it to change. When this nation's ready for us to stand down, we'll stand down, but it isn't time yet.
Congressman Gabbard, you serve on the Armed Services Committee. You are also a Guard officer. You live this yourself. What's your crystal ball say about the future of the Guard and Reserve and how this film maybe shows that future for subsequent brigade combat teams that will be called upon?
You know, what struck me about this film is that it communicates and tells the story of our National Guard brothers and sisters and what we've been up to, especially since after 9/11. And it explains it and shows it in such a deeply personal and real, raw way that a lot of folks within our communities across the country who are not in the National Guard have not been exposed to. And I will extend that even to our active duty brothers and sisters, who unfortunately, it's still there. The culture has changed a lot, but I can tell you in my day job, I still hear people and fellow veterans who've served in the active component saying, hey man, if the stuff hits the fan, I don't want a guard guy on my left or right. I want to know that, you know, somebody knows how to fight's going to be there. So when you not just tell the story, but show and feel and immerse someone in the story of what this Oklahoma National Guard unit did and accomplished and what they went through, I think it just helps lift the veil so much and lifts a lot of the misperception and misunderstanding that's out there. I can tell you, being on the Armed Services Committee, along with others, you know, Tammy Duckworth was in the National Guard. She just put down the uniform. Tim Walls, highest enlisted ranking member of Congress ever to serve. He's a retired Sergeant Major from the National Guard, also on the Armed Services Committee. So it provides some balance and maybe raising different questions or different concerns in a different voice than we get on a day-to-day basis from briefers coming from the Pentagon, and as you all know, probably the National Guard is often not represented in those day-to-day briefings. So, you know, where we go, I'm not going to claim to have any crystal ball, but I think it's important that we shape where we go by recognizing the high level of capabilities that our National Guard units have across the country, making sure that we learn from the lessons of the last 15 years or so, and make sure that we maintain that capability, because it is a service to the National Guard units and their mission to their state, but obviously to the country as well. And I'll just tell one little story, because it's the things that we don't often think about from our side, but talking to our National Guard unit back in Hawaii, as there are different readiness requirements coming out of the Pentagon for our reserve units, they're saying, okay, you've got to go to, you know, XCTC or JRTC or NTC, and you've got to meet these marks. But, you know, the questions that our operations guys are asking is, okay, that's fine, but are you leaving space, let's say, during the months of July and August for National Guard units to take those slots at NTC? Are you blocking off those dates away from the active duty so the National Guard units can rotate through during the times when people can take off school, they're expected to be able to take off work, and actually be able to go and make that mark and come out as a trained and ready unit, rather than having only half the unit show up and then you're not mission capable?
That's great. And Wendy, you worked in the Pentagon during this time. Your offices were somewhere in the third floor, E-ring, between 9 and 10 corridor, I think, that place where decisions get made. And so you had a window into the strategy in Afghanistan during this time. When I see this film, I'm reminded of the old maxim that you're looking at a battlefield through a soda straw. It's like looking at a satellite image or a UAV feed. You just see that one narrow piece. Zoom back for us. Help us understand the strategy in Afghanistan during this time and what's going on this battlefield that connects to that strategy.
Well, I think you know, really, what I'd like to do is associate myself really with the Congresswoman's comments more than anything. I think it was, at least in the period that I was there as a senior defense official working for then Deputy Secretary Ash Carter, the Guard was in moments rhetorically referred to as sort of equitable and up to par, but in most conversations privately was starting in 2010, 2011, which is when this film was covered, a deployment in 2011 with the Oklahoma National Guard, still sort of derided, not by Secretary Carter, but in the corridors around the Pentagon as sort of a stepchild, as a stepbrother, condescended to, you know, with adjectives or words like, well, it's just the Guard. You know, those sort of dismissive adjectival or adverbial phrases that are put in front of subjects that are dismissive. I noted that. It was obviously the time when General McKinley became, by an act of Congress, the chief of the National Guard Bureau, became a member of the Joint Chiefs, and that was a huge, monumental move, in my view, in the right direction in terms of ensuring that the Guard chief was an active, operational, intellectual policy contributor to this sort of elite military policy-making body that was a direct report for all intents and purposes, the Secretary of Defense and the President. But it was amazing to me that even though starting as early as 2005, you basically had half of all combat brigades in Iraq were National Guard. You had an increasing presence of National Guard in Afghanistan. You had numbers that were equaling numbers of active duty. You also had performance metrics. You had guardsmen and women who were hanging off a cliff in Lagan Province in 2011 who were performing as equitably and as competently as any active duty 20-year career Army officer. That's what's happened after 15 years of war with the National Guard. That is the transformation that General McKinley and the Congresswoman and Jason have all attested to, which Justin himself has lived. So for me, it was interesting trying to square the sort of backroom rhetoric, so to speak, with what I was seeing in terms of when I was in Afghanistan, reading the data, which supported something very different than the, you know, should we say, bias that I think had been ingrained over a long period of time, that whether it was true or not, and I won't get into that, certainly no longer holds now. And I wanted just to say one other thing before passing it back to Phil and my colleagues. You know, when David Salzberg and my other colleagues from Strong Eagle Media took a step back and said, you know, who is it that has fought these wars since 9/11? I mean, first of all, let's remember that our very first responders were the Air National Guard, very first, in F-15s and F-16s fighting in airspace, making sure that planes didn't go into the Capitol. Very first responders, very first. But really more than that, who, if we take a step back or achieve, you know, an altitude of 100,000 feet, who has fought these wars? And that really was the impetus for us to start figuring out whose stories we would tell with this film series. It's Big Army, it's Marine Corps, no doubt, it's our infantry. It's our Special Operations Forces, and we have a film coming out next year which is going to focus on the centrality of SOF to the post 9/11 wars. But it's also National Guard, and that there is an unprecedented historical role that the Guard has played that the data shows, which everybody on the panel has attested to, which has taken a number of our leaders of the other services, and even in the Department of Defense, as the Congresswoman pointed out, to catch up with. It takes us a minute to catch up, really, with the data. So the National Guard, not only because of the unprecedented historical role, but also because it is where our communities meet the national security mission of the country. It's the connective tissue between communities and what it is that we're doing abroad. And the primary objective in us focusing on the Guard here was to really say, you know, we have people all across this country, the less than 1% who've served, of which the National Guard is a sub, you know, component. But they really are your kids' teachers, and they're the neighbors, and they're the guys who are working on your car, or they're the guys who are, you know, helping you with your accounting, or they're the people in the community that hold the community together. It's people like Justin Smith and others who really, and Tulsi Gabbard, who are making that transition from civilian to warfighter to civilian to warfighter to civilian, and who often help us have insight and really provide that window into what it is that a significant a number of, you know, our service members have been doing for the last 15 years.
So we're going to go to questions in a minute, but I want to ask one more question, primarily of Jason and Congressman Gabbard. Beyond honoring the service of men and women like Sergeant Smith in this film, are there hard questions we should be asking about it? Are there things that the film leaves unasked, unsaid? Are there ways that we can honor service by asking those questions, particularly here in Washington, where we are now at a moment where we may be at an inflection point with the war in Afghanistan, where the time has come yet again to reassess our aims and think about the broader questions of this war? Jason, I know you've thought about this a lot.
And this is where it does get difficult, right? And I think one of the parts about this that's great about this film is that when you watch it, right, at the end of it, there should be no question that these men did their duty. But the interesting thing about the title is it's citizen soldiers. And so it raises a second question about if they're doing their duty as soldiers, what is our duty as citizens to ensure that the outcome matches the enormity of their sacrifice? And it's a very uncomfortable question. And not to put too fine a point on it, what is the status of the Sagal Valley, and do we care? Because that's the next step. This is an amazing public service in that it gets us thinking about what does war mean and what does it mean for these men and women to go back and forth to war? But then the question on us is, to what end? And do we pay sufficient attention? Do we serve well enough as citizens to justify their sacrifice?
Congresswoman?
Yeah, to that. Yeah, my hope is that across this country, when we are confronted with the cost of war, is that we think about those who bear that cost. And it's not just about people in Washington making the decisions, although it is. It is our collective responsibility to ask those questions and to hold leaders accountable, to learn lessons from the past, to make sure that the decisions that we're making about our troop strength, about mobilizations, about how we are supporting both the active and guard and reserve components so that they can be successful, and about how we are supporting them and taking care of them when they come home. You know, every day I can't tell you how many veterans I hear from in my district who are pleading for help, pleading and begging for help. About 10 days ago, I got a message from my constituent services representative on the island of Hawaii saying there's a Vietnam veteran here who's dying of lung cancer, and he only has a few days left to live, but he would really love to have the chance to speak with you. I was here in DC, so I called him as soon as I could later that day, and you could tell he was on, it was the last breaths of his life. I could barely hear him. The Vietnam veteran who started telling me about the nightmares that still wake him up at night, that he can't shake from the things that happened and the things that he did in Vietnam, asking me to promise him that I make sure I do everything that I can to take care of our brothers and sisters and to make sure that our country learns its lessons from the past. He passed away just a couple of days later, but these are the things that weigh heavily upon my heart as we look at the individual experiences and the collective experiences and the people who are coming home and making sure that we do right by them in every way.
From the audience, if you raise your hand, and we got a mic coming around from Andrew, and I think one on this side. Jane, please.
Thank you for letting me ask a question. I want to say, first of all, thank you for making the movie. It is really special to see. My husband was in the 45th and was killed 6 days before Sergeant Prince. I speak on my own behalf, but I'm very proud to say I recently joined on with the Embassy of Afghanistan. I'm their congressional and military liaison. And the reason why I joined on is because of this film and exactly what Jason Dempsey said. What do Americans care about how the Sagal Valley is and what it is today? You know, we have all these veterans that are coming home from war with all the wounds of war, but we're not telling them as a country, and we're not putting out any media about why they're over there, the good that has come of it. You know, there's more women in Afghanistan in Parliament than we have in Congress. Why aren't we telling our service members why they were over there? Why aren't we telling the American people? We've definitely been in America at peace and a military at war. And I don't mean to be the person that gets up with the microphone and gives a comment instead of a question. But I guess I would love to hear you guys comment on that. I just wanted to share my heart with that and how much it means to me. And something that I've kept very, very, very private until lately. But one of the last things, many people here have never seen me cry, so I apologize. But one of the last things that my husband ever wrote me from Afghanistan was, why fight a war if we gain nothing from winning? And I promise for the rest of my life, I will make it worth it for all of them. So I just give that baton over to each and every one of you, too. We've done a lot of good work over there, and I just hope that we can continue it. So.
Justin.
So, first off, I told you before, you've got carte blanche. You can do what you want. I think the last time, maybe time before last, that I watched this film, my wife was able to attend with me, and there was another Gold Star wife there, and Shirley ended up sitting next to her, and it's Serena Prince, and the part where Michael died came up in the movie, and she understandably had a hard time with it, and Shirley moved down from the guy. Oh, it was Sergeant Byrne, was sitting next to her. He got up to go get tissues, left a vacant seat. Shirley got up and moved down and sat next to her and just held her hand. That was it. And she talked to me later and said, I felt I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what else to do. So I just held her hand and I just sat there and just let her cry. And we're walking out of the theater, and she was leaning on me. It was a real sweet moment. And she asked a question just like that. And I think it's a very relevant question. And to some people, with a level of understanding, there's a definite answer. To others, they need to hear it from the ones that know. So I would suggest the following. She said, if that is what it is, and this is what we get back, if all we get back are dead soldiers or broken soldiers, why in the world do we keep going? You know what? That's a very fair question. And my answer as a soldier to her was, well, sweetheart, the world's broken. And for the time being, there are just bad people. And bad people do bad things, and typically they do them to good people. And there has to be, necessarily, there has to be somebody to stand in between and fill that gap. That's an old saying, right? Stand in the gap. Anybody hear that before? There has to be somebody to stand there and fill that role. And for the time being, for the rest of the time, the world is broken. That's what we do, and this is an extra part of the sacrifice that I don't think gets a lot of attention. A lot of the guys and girls that enlist to do this job enlist knowing at least of, if not intimately, what that means to do. And I don't know, I thought I'd just share that related personal experience in response to otherwise very relevant, very good comments.
Thank you. Todd?
Steal yours. First, I'd just like to say I'm proud to be your voice in the Pentagon as the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Manpower and Reserve Affairs. I'm an active combat veteran, but I'll tell you, my heart has always been with the National Guard. You know that. One of the most important things that I saw in the film, other than the film in general, was actually at the end, where you showed some devastation in the state and the National Guard in response. And I think that's one of the things that sticks in my heart all the time is the job that the Guard does that makes it so unique in doing the state mission and then going overseas on the front lines of our community, on the front lines in battle. And I think that's very important and something we always need to cherish about the Guard. Quick question for you. Did you lose anyone after the fact to suicide?
Thank you for asking that question. No, we haven't. To date, we haven't lost one guy, and I believe very strongly that that is something I mentioned before. I think it's completely and inextricably tied to that. Remember how I said that they disbanded us right after we got home? But we still behave as if we are a unit. Sergeant Byrne medically retired out. On the phone, in person, doesn't matter. There's some guys that still go to parade rest for the man. he was a tad bit intimidating. So I can understand that on a personal level. But those are the connections that we formed, and we dwelled in those connections together, and we continued that relationship. So as leaders, you fill the needs of your soldiers, no matter what they are. I've taught just as many guys to balance a checkbook and manage their marital conflicts as I have trained them on Battle Drill 1 Alpha and how to break down a 240 machine gun and put it back into operation. It's just whatever the soldier needs at the time. And that's on an officer level, that's on a non-commissioned officer level, that's just the role that a leader fulfills to his men or women, be they soldiers, sailors, airmen, or Marines, I wholeheartedly believe. And I think that that's chiefly the reason that we haven't lost anybody. We've had a couple of guys that came really close, that walked right up to the edge and looked over into the abyss, and they either chose to make the call, or it's funny, isn't it, how you'll get the call just at the right time. Hey, man, how you doing? Haven't heard from you in a while. And that was it, just reaching out and just touch, just contact, just no soldier left behind, ever.
Bill, just to your point, Secretary Carter and his leadership team, which you are a principal member of, and our senior uniform people really do get it today. Now, it won't always be that way, and it's an ebb and a flow. But over the weekend, we had, pressure cooker bomb in New York City and Elizabethtown, New Jersey, and guess who put 1,000 people on duty? It was Governor Cuomo. Our founding fathers built it into our Constitution that the National Guard can do both. And our governors are the commanders in chief in peacetime. So guess what their first duty is when they become governor? They learn what that title means. So it's just a wonderful relationship. We were in Louisiana here recently with the floods, the hurricanes, typhoons that just went by Hawaii the other day. I mean, it's just who we are. And it works. It works. And people get it now. But we got to continue to reinforce it. And I think that's what this movie does.
So I noticed at the end you had made notation of the Soviets having last been there in 1979. I got to go to Afghanistan in 2013, and my first impression was of the memories that the Russian soldiers who had been in Afghanistan had shared when I worked with them decades earlier in Russia. And so I was curious to know if anybody has ever done that, and we were talking about a historical perspective, has anybody looked back at what the Russians experienced, their PTSD, and that's why I was there, was to deal with and treat PTSD in Russian veterans who had been in Afghanistan. Has anybody looked at those experiences and looked at the commonalities between those experiences and the lessons maybe we could have learned and could still learn from the Soviets' experience?
Question. Looking at Jason, who's the ringer on the panel.
I think it is, yeah, and totally out of my depth. I think it's a great question only because, you know, we have seen a couple books, and we only belatedly said, well, what happened to the Soviets? And it all relates to, I think, our American arrogance to a degree that we just assume that, well, the Soviets went in, they were inherently evil, they did a lot of things, and they just all got killed, and the Russians threw them out. Well, guess what? The Russians didn't think they were acting like that. And so it's helpful, right? No, yeah, to a degree. Your average Russian soldier, right, I guarantee if you ask 1,000 of them, they thought they were on the side of good. You know, and so running in and fighting and, you know, probably seeing the moral injury, they probably had to deal with that when they were asked to bomb or do something they were uncomfortable with. So we're only now saying, well, gee, they kind of had a hard time just fighting and taming places like the Sagal Valley. And, oh, yeah, we couldn't do it either as easily as we thought we could. So I do think it's we can learn from even those that we think we're superior to. So I think it's a great question.
Sergeant Smith.
A great question, and probably we are not doing enough. Wendy may have a comment from her time in the Pentagon, but I'll tell you, the National Guard units that I'm familiar with have opened their doors, and their leadership has said to all reservists, please come. Please be part of our team. We know what you're going through. We can help. So in some of these very small towns, there are armories, and they can go to those armories and get some camaraderie, some psychological help, and that, and get plugged into the VA. But we're missing many of them, as Congresswoman Gabbard said. So it's a great point, and I'll pass that on to the folks that I still work with in the Pentagon and make sure that we don't let anybody slip through the cracks.
So we've got time for one last question, and I'll go back up here to Dave LaPan.
First, thank you all for doing this, the film, this event here, and all of you for your service, to include you, Wendy, for all that time in the building. You certainly deserve medals for those. But I'd like to pull the string on something that you said a little earlier about the connective tissue. So obviously you had this great combat footage that happened to be from a guard unit. So you couldn't make a film without having the footage to do so. But how important was it, and what part of the calculation for you and David and the others were there in thinking about this film being more approachable to the average American because of the guard component? You know, maybe this, by focusing on guardsmen and showing them in their civilian capacities, would it make this film more relatable to the general public who doesn't understand the military by and large? Was that part of the calculation?
David, I appreciate it a lot. And listen, back at you. Thank you, too. You and I had a lot of years doing a lot of difficult things sort of behind the scenes. So I just really appreciate how steadfast you've been of this entire effort. You know, it was. I mean, really, one of the reasons we wanted to focus in on the Guard is that nothing like this has ever been told about the Guard, right? You know, you sort of get big Army, you get Marines, you get SOF. I mean, in a way, they're sexier for the general public. Or it somehow seems like, even if it's not as known or knowable, there's a mystery. It's, I don't know, it has been a little bit more potent, I think, in the imagination of Americans. Hollywood has sort of shown us that in recent years. But one of the things that we thought about the Guard is that it brings it home, right? It's your cousin or your uncle or your sibling, or, like we said, you know, the teacher of your kids, or it's a part of what your daily life has been. And in a film, which of course I didn't know until 2 years ago, because I was doing something very different with my life at that point, was there are thousands of decisions that you have to make about where you focus and how you tell a story and, you know, what it is that you emphasize. And when we thought about whose stories do we want to tell, the Guards became so clear in our minds because it is who you know, right? I mean, we know that less than 1% of the American population has served in these wars since 9/11. Those of us in this room have had, I would imagine, have direct experience or ourselves have served as a civilian or as a National Guard's man or woman or in active duty. We have that direct experience. Most people don't. And I don't know that there's animus at all, like we saw in previous wars, but there's a kind of ignorance. There's an education gap. There's an intimacy gap. And so one of the things we thought about was, well, the Guard is that connective tissue, and it completes something in the education chain, right? You know someone, you can relate analogically, somehow you can then connect because you have this person in your daily life. So it was one of the animating sort of circumstances behind why it is that we wanted to tell the story. And another one, frankly, is that, you know, we thought, well, we could tell the domestic mission of the Guard, as Todd pointed out, you know, but folks know that for the most part, not always. They see the responses to Katrina, they see the recent flooding in Louisiana, they see what's recently happened in New York, New Jersey, et cetera, and that's a more familiar mission, the domestic mission. What I think has been less understood is this tremendous set of contributions that our National Guard men and women have played on the battlefield. And we just made a set of decisions to focus on that in the film, but we wanted to make sure and have some transitions back, which we, you know, showed through the guys hanging out at the, you know, the grill in Oklahoma City, sort of reflecting on their experiences. So it was interesting to figure out how do we make those transitions real? I mean, how do we sort of give the feel of the citizen who's come back and is trying to process the experiences of being deployed and that frequent transition, you know, as I mentioned earlier, between warfighter and citizen. One of the things, Phil, if you don't mind, that I wanted to say is just sort of ending comments for myself that you all did not see, that's maybe one of the most important pieces of Citizen Soldier, is one of the, you know, reasons why we wanted to do the film, in addition to the reasons that I elucidated a minute ago, is to memorialize those who have died. Jane's husband, for example. And we went to the National Guard Bureau and said, you know, we'd really like to end the film with a list, a National Guard honor scroll, which we did some research on and found out had never quite been done. So we assumed that the National Guard Bureau had that list. Well, interestingly, they didn't. And maybe I should have known that. Maybe I should have understood that each state, territory, and the District of Columbia would have kept its own list of its own fallen. Well, that's what was true. And what was interesting to us is that the film became a forcing function to put together the first ever definitive, comprehensive, at least as of March 29th of 2016, National Guard Honor Scroll. It's never been done. And there are 803 men and women from every single state and territory in the District of Columbia who have died in Iraq and Afghanistan serving this country as a National Guard man or woman. We didn't know it didn't exist. The film gave us an opportunity to put that together. And what you see at the end of the film, and I would encourage all of you, if you know, if it's your heart, to spend some time with the film. You know, you can get it in Walmart or download it on a number of digital networks. But it ends with that memorial tribute. Each flag of each state, territory, in the district, on, you know, where the names of the list of the fallen are superimposed over it. And what was so surprising to me, in addition to the fact that the list didn't exist before we had this opportunity to put it together, and we worked with the Guard Bureau and all the tags to do that for 5 months to make sure that we didn't make a mistake, and we may have, but we've tried very hard not to do that, is the fact that the families have gotten involved, the Gold Star families have gotten involved. We've had a number of folks who have wanted to be a part, you know, of this first ever honor scroll. So I would just encourage you to recognize that, you know, one of the reasons why we wanted to do the film was to honor those who have contributed so immensely in unrecognized ways. And when you get a chance to view the honor scroll, please, you know, please do that and share it with folks so that they understand what the full contribution of the Guard is and what really the 21st century Guard looks like after 15 years of involvement in Iraq and Afghanistan. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Wendy, and thank you to your team at Strong Eagle Media for producing this film. Thank you all for joining us tonight, and thank you to Spark Cognition for underwriting this screening here in D.C. Really want to encourage you all, if you want to learn more about the Guard and Reserve, you can obviously look at our website. You can also look at some of the work that the National Guard Association and others in the space have done on the work of the National Guard and the Reserve components. Thank you again, and please have a good evening.